surgical excision, usually complete, and then followed by imatinib as life now.
So there is 2 centimeter also option in that, right? Is it only 5 centimeter?
No, sir. Anything above this, sir.
You must above look into the age. Okay, right.
Yes, sir.
We will move on to the next presenter. Thank you. So this comes to conclusion of the posters. We next have the e-scientific paper presentation. We will start off with the postgraduates from Vaidehi Institute. The first presenter would be Dr. Chandana P. Reddy, who will be doing an e-scientific paper presentation on a comparative study of endovenous laser ablation with sclerotherapy to Trendelenburg procedure with stripping for varicose veins.
Good evening. I am Dr. Chandana. Today I'll be presenting a paper about comparative study of conventional surgery with endovenous laser ablation and sclerotherapy for varicose vein under guidance of Dr. Ramesh Reddy. Varicose veins are one of the most common venous disorders. Common treatment is surgical ligation and stripping of the affected vein, which is invasive and usually requiring several weeks for recovery. Whereas endovenous treatment is a minimally invasive technique, which catheter-based technique, which causes damage to the endothelial wall of the target vessel to produce thrombosis, fibrosis, eventually eradication of the vessel. EVLA utilizes a small flexible glass fiber that is inserted into the vein. Laser energy is transmitted down the fiber and is absorbed at the point of treatment and end of the fiber. All laser wavelengths are equally efficacious, but there is less pain and bruising with higher wavelength lasers. EVLA uses a 600 micrometer bare tip fiber to deliver laser energy to a target area and form steam bubbles within the vein lumen. These steam bubbles generate heat within the lumen of the target vessel, which destroys the lining of the vessel, further causing inflammatory reaction resulting in thrombotic occlusion that effectively closes the vein and eventually leading to fibrosis. Sclerotherapy is nothing but injecting chemical into the vein lumen, which causes endothelial damage, further thrombosis, and eventually fibrosis. In my study, I've used a detergent type of sclerosant, that is sodium tetradecyl sulfate. My aim of the study is to compare the effectiveness of EVLA and sclerotherapy with conventional surgery of varicose veins with regard to duration of surgery, post-operative complications, and duration of hospital stay. The source of data for study are all patients with varicose veins admitted in our department from July 2019 to Feb 2021. It's a prospective comparative study. Inclusion criteria being patients with varicose vein with SFJ incompetence or perforator incompetence, age more than 18 years, and also patients who are willing to give consent for the study. Exclusion criteria being recurrent varicose veins, SPJ incompetence, and SSV incompetence. All patients underwent routine investigation and venous Doppler. The accessories used in EVLA are bare optical fiber and radial optical fiber. Both are 600 micrometer in diameter. Difference is radial optical fiber has 1 centimeter markings, and also it is disposable. Bare optical fiber can be used 10 times. Catheter set that it contains sheath introducer, guide wire, and a puncture needle, 18 gauge cannula. The laser equipment used here is a diode laser, 1470 nanometer wavelength, continuous waveforms, generate 80 joules per centimeter heat. There are two important steps in EVLA. First is to cannulate the vein, second is to ablate. GSV is cannulated using 18 gauge needle, blindly or using ultrasound guidance. Once the laser fiber is advanced, vein endothelium is ablated. Patient is induced with spinal anesthesia. Great saphenous vein is cannulated using 18 gauge needle. Once cannulated, 0.035 guide wire is passed, cannula is removed, and sheath introducer is placed. 600 micrometer bare-tipped or jacket-tipped laser fiber is introduced up till 1 to 2 centimeter below saphenofemoral junction. Laser is set at 7 to 8 watt, which releases heat of 80 joules per centimeter. Laser fiber is withdrawn at the rate of 1 centimeter every 3 to 5 seconds. Sheath introducer is removed, and the pressure dressing is done. For perforator incompetence, foam sclerotherapy is used. Sodium tetradical sulfate is used here. The last picture depicting before after picture after all the treatment. Randomization done in ratio of 1:1 alternatively. The study result was analyzed by using independent sample system and chi-square test. This is a demographic representation. P-value nothing significant. Types of surgery done are endovenous laser ablation with sclerotherapy and perforator ligation, Trendelenburg procedure with perforator ligation and stripping of vein. There is significant decrease in duration of surgery. EVLA per leg, we took about 20 to 30 minutes, whereas conventional study requires more time. Also, there is significant decrease in stay in hospital. EVLA is a daycare procedure. Also, there are less complications such as sensory disturbances, phlebitis, infection, hematoma, and DVT. The study demonstrated that both treatments are safe and effective, but EVLA has shorter duration of surgery, shorter hospital stay, and lesser complications, better cosmetic outcome. Other supporting journals are RCT done by Samuel et al. Suggests that equivalent improvement in clinical severity and non-inferiority of EVLA compared with conventional surgery. The immediate post-operative benefits and short-term technical outcomes of EVLA would support the future consideration of this procedure as standard treatment of greater saphenous vein insufficiency. Also, another study done by Cardis D. et al., the treatment outcomes of GSV and SSV incompetence following surgery and endovenous laser ablation. EVLA is as effective as conventional surgery. Lesser post-operative complications can, hence it can be considered as treatment option for varicose veins. So advantages of EVLA are, it is less invasive, less operating time, less post-operative pain, less post-operative complications, lesser duration of hospital stay, also better cosmetic outcome. Hence I conclude, EVLA is a promising alternative for management of varicose veins. However, the study needs vast sample and longer follow-up period to comprehend the findings. These are my references.
You're open for any questions?
Did both the groups had ligation of the saphenofemoral junction?
Yes, sir.
Okay. How did you calculate the sample size?
Sample size was calculated keeping 90% as the thing. So.
Okay. You use the chi-square test in this case, no?
Yes, sir. Independent samples test and chi-square test.
Okay. Chi-square is a quantitative or a qualitative? Is a test of qualitative measure or a quantitative measure?
Quantitative measure.
Okay. The type of anesthesia used in both the surgeries?
Spinal anesthesia.
In both?
Yes, sir. In both.
Okay. In spinal, you prefer the daycare in spinal?
Sir, actually, we can do it with intravenous local anesthesia, so tumescent anesthesia. But I have used only spinal anesthesia here in my studies.
Okay. In this, both the procedures are done by the same surgeon or two different surgeons?
No, sir. Same surgeon. It's operated in our unit, sir. Same surgeon.
Same surgeon. Okay. Thank you.
Any more questions?
So yeah. No questions. Can I ask just one an observation?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, can I comment on one thing?
Yes, sir.
What is the tumescent, not there is a flow, scleral foam sclerotherapy done? What are the things you used?
Sir, here I have used a detergent type of sclerosensor, that is sodium tetradecyl sulfate, sir.
How do you make a foam, that one?
Sir, using 2 10 ml syringes and 3-way cannula, sir. And
what is the dilution ratio?
Sir, here we have taken 4 ml, sir. There's no dilution, sir.
4 ml of?
Sodium tetradecyl sulfate, sir. 2 vials have been taken, sir. No dilution, sir.
What is the quantity used for sclerotherapy total?
So 4 ml. 2 vials of sodium tetradecyl sulfate, 4 ml.
Each vial, I know it contains 4 ml, 2 ml.
Yes, sir.
Each leg used 4 ml of sodium STD. What is the
maximum? Sir, only for the dilated perforators we have used foam sclerotherapy, sir. Per leg, maximum limit, that is 4 ml, sir. So how much ever was required, that was injected.
You make a foam, right?
Yes, sir. For each perforator, about 0.5 ml of that foam.
Yeah, foam. What is the See, maximum dosage you can give the per body of the total legs is, you should not cross more than 14 ml of whole foam. Not to say STD, you should not use so much. Number one. Number two, when you are doing a laser thing with the combination, you should, what do you do for, where do you puncture that? With all the veins, you puncture the below the elbow?
Yes, sir. Below the knee, sir. Below knee, sir.
Hello?
Yes,
below
sir.
Knee.
Below knee,
so
we are cannulating the veins.
Below knee, you cannulated the vein, right? What do you did for the below knee vein perforators? You did a laser or you did only foam sclerotherapy?
Laser only, sir. Sir, foam sclerotherapy was done only for the perforator, sir.
No, for the... Yeah, that's what. See, there is a lot of controversy when you do the foam sclerotherapy and laser combination. We should not both, most of the time, we should not both together the combination, okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, that's number one. Because then number two, what I say is, even the game for selective cannulation, you have to do the selective cannulation from foam sclerotherapy. And if there is a sclera, this is what you call perforators along the GSV, you don't need to do the foam sclerotherapy separately. Because you take care of, we do the laser, it takes care of the problem of the perforators also.
Yes, sir. Only for the prominent perforators we have injected, sir. Otherwise,
sir, and for tributaries, it is being done.
Sir, otherwise, the main GSV is ablated, sir. That's it.
Okay. For shortage of time,
next presentation.
You can go for the next presentation. This is a prospective study on effect of hyperbaric oxygen therapy, HBOT, on diabetic ulcers by Dr. Sri Vachan from Vaidehiya.
Sir, there are some questions in the chat box. I think the PGs can answer later in the chat box.
5 minutes, I
passed.
Yes,
Good evening, everyone. My topic is a study on the effect of hyperbaric oxygen therapy on diabetic ulcers. Hyperbaric oxygen therapy is a non-invasive therapy which is used as an adjuvant treatment in many medical conditions over the past 50 years. Initially, it was used to treat decompression sickness in drivers. Subsequently, it has been applied to treat other conditions, including ulcers. Diabetic ulcers are the main reason for hospitalization, for accounting up to 25% of admissions in diabetics. 15% of the diabetic patients develop diabetic ulcer during their lifetime. If untreated, they end up in amputation. And henceforth, aggressive management is required to improve the quality of life, control infections, maintain patient health, and prevent amputations. Current standard wound care protocols include wound cleansing, optimized glycemic control, treating infection, improving blood supply, relieving the pressure on the wound site. Therefore, ideally, all the phases of wound healing are all oxygen dependent. In an endeavor to improve the healing rates, hyperbaric oxygen therapy is being used. Treatment involves placing the patient in a compression chamber and administering 100% oxygen at a pressure between 2 to 2.5 atmospheric absolutes for a period of 90 minutes once daily. A typical course might involve 15 to 30 such treatments. In accordance with Henry's law, the amount of oxygen dissolved in the plasma is directly proportional to the pressure exerted by the oxygen. Therefore, in pressures of 2 to 2.4 ATA, there will be increased partial pressure of oxygen at the subcutaneous tissue level. Therefore, more oxygen is dissolved in the plasma and rendered to the tissues. Whenever there is damage or restriction to the blood flow due to injury, disease, or a clot, there will be RBCs will be blocked off from the blood. So, however, little plasma will still flow through the damaged blood vessel. However, tissues will still undergo necrosis due to the lack of oxygen. But in presence of hyperbaric conditions, the plasma, oxygen will be already dissolved in the plasma and this can be rendered into the tissues. Hyperbaric oxygen therapy uses oxygen as a drug and hyperbaric oxygen apparatus as a delivery system to give oxygen at high pressures. Oxygen is required, it plays an important role in production of reactive oxygen species like superoxides and the synthesis of endothelial cell. Nitric oxide synthesis, which help in stimulation of various growth factors, including vascular endothelial growth factor, platelet-derived growth factor, keratinocyte growth factor, and epithelial growth factor, which help in angiogenesis, fibroplasia, and contraction, and re-epithelialization. Oxygen also helps to increase the leukocytic action and to maintain the cutaneous microvascular reflexes. The main aim of the study was to assess the rate of healing of ulcers and to measure the rate of reduction of ulcer in the mean ulcer surface area. To assess the efficacy of hyperbaric oxygen therapy along with standard wound care compared to standard wound care alone through the assessment of wound closure. Source of data is all the patients with clinically diagnosed diabetic ulcers presenting in our OPD at WIMS and RC for a period of October 19 to February 2021. This is a prospective comparative study where the baseline data, clinical findings, basic investigation report was obtained a pre-structured pro forma. Written informed consent was taken and an ethical committee approval was sought. Inclusion criteria involved the diabetic ulcers of age between 20 to 70 years and consenting for the procedure. However, exclusion criteria, there was impending urgent amputation due to exacerbated infections, exposed bone with no prospect of weight-bearing potential, even if the defect has been healed. It was a single-center study with 30 subjects. The patients were randomized alternatively. In group A, with 15 patients, standard wound care was given with adjunct hyperbaric oxygen therapy. And in group B, only standard wound care was given. Patients were matched for, using frequency distribution to ensure both the groups are comparable at baseline. In group A, 100% oxygen with increased atmospheric pressure about 2 to 2.5 ATA was given in a monoplace chamber for 5 days a week, 90 minutes daily for about 20 sessions in accordance with our hospital SVOT protocols under qualified medical supervision. Care is to be taken to follow all the safety protocols. Treatment pressures were matched with the chamber pressure and then the timer was started. Continuous monitoring and medical supervision is needed throughout the procedure. In both the groups, standard wound care was offered. The wound was cleansed with sterile saline solution. Any superficial slough was present was debrided with scalpel. Wound measurement was conducted after thorough cleansing. Dressings were changed after every 2 days. Tracing paper was used with a printed grid was used to calculate the wound area. Sterile probes and calipers were used to calculate the wound depth. This is an image of the wound post disarticulation, which was infected. After 14 days with 10 sessions of SVOT, we can see the gradual reduction in the wound size under the formation of red granulation tissue. And at the 28th day, after 20 sessions of SVOT, the wound size is significantly decreased. On the right side is another wound, which after 5 sessions of SVOT on the 7th day showed gradual improvement and increase in the granulation tissue. This is another ulcer with ulcer over the plantar and dorsal aspect of the left foot, which was completely healed at the end of 28 days after 20 sessions of hyperbaric oxygen therapy. Appropriate statistical methods were employed. The data was normally distributed as shown in the Shapiro-Wilkes test, and the independent sample t-test was employed to compare the differences between the groups. All the characteristics are matched at baseline, so, like age, gender, weight, HbA1c levels, and the location of the ulcer with in accordance to the grading of Wagner's classification. Moving on to the results, the mean surface area in centimeter square, when we plot it against time in weeks, there was in group A, the mean ulcer area is significantly smaller than group B at the end of week 4. the reduction in the wound area, that is 3.75 centimeters square in group A versus 1.05 centimeter in group B, was pronounced in group A. Coming to the wound depth, there was significant difference in between the two groups, and there was a significant reduction at the end of group 3 itself in group A. Both the groups were both groups demonstrated a significant improvement in wound reduction by the end of the trial. However, ulcer area and depth exhibited superior improvement in group A. The present study has demonstrated that adjunct HPOT enhances reduction in ulcer area at depth at 4 weeks in type 2 diabetes patient with ulcers. Tiaka et al. In the study showed that hyperbaric oxygen therapy is known to ensure hyperoxygenation of the ischemic tissue and restoration from hypoxia. Perrin et al. Showed leukocytes kill bacteria more effectively when supplied with oxygen. Also, hyperbaric oxygen therapy improves quality of life in patients with chronic diabetic ulcers, possibly attributed to better ulcer healing, has been reported in this study. New in this study is the elimination of confounding variables known to affect the healing by tight control matching between the two groups. This represents the main strength of the study, and we are confident that the improvement in wound healing was indeed due to the inclusion of hyperbaric oxygen therapy and as an adjunct treatment to standard wound care. Limitation is a small number of patients, that caution was taken while interpretation of results. Conclusion: our results add to the growing evidence on utility of hyperbaric oxygen therapy in the management of diabetic ulcers. Nevertheless, optimum patient selections and long-term results of this treatment modality is still needed for its wider use to be advocated. These are my references.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello.
Hello. The topic is open for discussion.
Hello. Hello, doctor.
Yes, sir.
I am Dr. Mahesh, plastic surgeon. Okay, nice presentation. I have a few questions to ask you. So one is, are you going to use this hyperbaric oxygen for the chronic diabetic ulcer? The reason is there will be a fibrous barrier, you know, the between the ulcer and the cells. Okay, so during in that case, the oxygen may not penetrate to the cells. That is the one issue. And second is, all these cases, you need to do arteriogram before that arterial Doppler. Need to assess the vascularity, because the cause could be either hyperglycemia or neuropathy, or it could be because of arteriopathy. Okay, it may work in the cases of the patients with arteriopathy. That is second. And the third is, if the you are you going to do the culture, both qualitative and is qualitative quantitative, because if the culture is showing the aerobic culture, aerobic bacteria, something like protease and all, okay, so this hyperbaric oxygen, sometimes it can precipitate the further infection. Okay. So are you going to use it for the,
Standard wound care has to be given, sir. Appropriate antibiotics according to culture sensitivity is given, and hyperbaric oxygen therapy is given as an adjunct therapy, not as the sole therapy for the treatment of the chronic wound, sir.
I have one thing for the questions. Please, no, judges have to ask questions, because this is an award paper. So the PG has to answer. Comments, if we have time, we can add, or can be typed in the chat box.
By biopsy, you want to rule anything before doing the hyperbaric therapy?
Sir, if any malignancy or anything is there, we'll have to rule out, sir.
But it is not mentioned in your thing, no? And in your title, it is not mentioned as a comparative study. You've taken it as a comparative study.
It was a prospective comparative study, sir.
But in your title, it's not mentioned. Okay, what was the selection criteria in this randomization?
Sir, randomization was done like alternatively, sir. There was no particular selection criteria. Only the diabetic ulcers with which were like non-healing. It did not have any acute exacerbated infection to do any amputation.
Okay.
Hello.
Sir.
Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. See, got nice presentation. I know it's a new therapy that now you're doing. But thing is, before doing getting into the trial, this one you need to check for the what Dr. Mahesh asked you. You need to check for the vascularity status.
Yes.
Number one. Okay. Number two, before doing the site away into the put into the oxygen therapy, we need to get into the debride the wound properly. What yes, he sir. Said is that the fibrous scar tissue will be there.
Sir, as told initially, standard wound care was offered. Sir. Arterial Doppler was done, but it is not.
We'll go for the next case, sir.
We'll go to the next case. Sorry, shortage of time.
Thank
Can
you.
Can we go to the next paper? Hyperbilirubinemia as a diagnostic marker in acute appendicitis and its role as a predictor in appendicular perforation by Dr. Hamsa.
Good evening to one and all. Today, my paper for today evening is a study of hyperbilirubinemia as a diagnostic marker in acute appendicitis and its role as a predictor in appendicular perforation. The most common cause of acute abdomen is acute appendicitis. Lifetime risk for appendicitis is 8.6% for males and 6.7% for females, with the highest incidence in the second decade of life. The diagnosis is based on clinical history and physical examination. Based on the clinical suspicion alone can lead to the removal of the normal appendix in around 15% of the cases. Study shows that increased serum bilirubin helps in the diagnosis of acute appendicitis and as a predictor of appendicular perforation. On bacterial invasion of the appendix, there is transmigration of bacteria and release of pro-inflammatory cytokines like tumor necrosis factor alpha and interleukin 6. These cytokines reach the liver through the superior mesenteric vein and trigger the cholestasis by affecting the hepatocellular and bile duct function. In case of acute appendicitis or perforation, because of the release of the inflammatory markers, there's transmigration or translocation of the bacterial toxins and cytokines. This leads to the endotoxemia and bacteremia, which leads to the invasion of the bacteria into the hepatic parenchyma, interferes with the physiology of excretion of bile, in turn leading into hyperbilirubinemia. The most common bacterial species causing acute appendicitis are E. coli and bacteroids. These organisms invade with the hepatic microcirculation and cause sinusoidal damage. E. coli endotoxin can also lead to the impaired bile production. In view of the above context, the present study was undertaken to assess the relationship between hyperbilirubinemia and acute appendicitis and to evaluate its credibility as diagnostic marker for acute appendicitis and also to see whether elevated bilirubin levels have a predictive potential for diagnosis of appendicular perforation. Objectives of the study was to correlate between the hyperbilirubinemia and acute appendicitis, to evaluate its usefulness as a diagnostic marker for acute appendicitis, and to assess whether elevated bilirubin levels have a predictive potential for the diagnosis of appendicular perforation. It was a prospective study. The source of the data was from all the patients presenting with acute appendicitis admitted to general surgery in Vaidehi Institute of Medical College. Study period was from November 2019 to April 2021. The total number of patients included in the study were 70. The data was collected from case recording performers pertaining to patients, particulars, history, clinical examination, investigations, diagnosis, and surgical procedures. The statistical analysis was performed by STAT 11.2. The inclusion criteria for the study was the patients willing to give consent, patients diagnosed with acute appendicitis clinically on admission, and patients clinically suspected with appendicular perforation on admission. Exclusion criteria was patients not willing to give consent and all patients documented to have a past history of jaundice or liver disease, chronic alcoholism, hemolytic disease, acquired or congenital biliary disease, and all patients with positive HBsAg, cholelithiasis, and cancer of hepatobiliary system, and patients with appendicular mass. The clinical criteria to diagnose acute appendicitis was the presence of pain abdomen, presence or absence of nausea or vomiting, presence or absence of fever, and presence or absence of rebound tenderness in right ilia fossa. The clinical criteria used to diagnose appendicular perforation was presence of pain abdomen, nausea, vomiting, fever, rebound tenderness in right ilia fossa, and localized guarding. According to our study, the preoperatively out of 70 patients, acute appendicitis was clinically diagnosed in 60, and appendicular perforation was diagnosed in 10 patients. Coming to the results, the pain abdomen was seen in almost 100% of all the patients with appendicular perforation and in acute appendicitis, whereas a fever was seen in 100% of patients with appendicular perforation, but in only 9% of the patients with acute appendicitis. Whereas the rebound tenderness was present in 100% of patients with appendicular perforation and in only in 2% with acute appendicitis. The leukocyte count, it was raised in all the patients with appendicular perforation, but it was raised only in 67% of patients with acute appendicitis. The total bilirubin levels in acute these are the graph showing total bilirubin levels in acute appendicitis and appendicular perforation. It was abnormal in all the patients with appendicular perforation, whereas it was abnormal only in 46% of patients with acute appendicitis. This is a graph showing direct bilirubin, which was raised in all patients with appendicular perforation. And this is the levels of indirect bilirubin levels. Whereas the liver enzymes were normal in both the acute appendicitis and appendicular perforation patients. Intraoperatively, acute appendicitis was diagnosed in 44 patients, and appendicular perforation was diagnosed in 16. And 16 patients. In USG, abdomen pelvis, acute appendicitis was diagnosed in 44 patients, and appendicular perforation was diagnosed in 10 patients. Correlation of the acute appendicitis and appendicular perforation by the levels is, it was seen that in patients with appendicular perforation, the abnormal total bilirubin levels was seen in all 16 patients, whereas it was abnormal only in 13 patients with acute appendicitis. And bilirubin levels repeated on the postoperative day 3 were found to be within normal limits. Coming to discussion, the diagnosis of appendicitis still remains dilemma in spite of the various laboratory and radiological investigations. Serum bilirubin level elevation will help in the accuracy of clinical diagnosis of acute appendicitis, and more importantly, help in foreseeing and preventing impending complications of acute appendicitis. According to the Binion et al. Study, it was told that bacterial endotoxin causes physiological bile flow obstruction, and the likelihood of appendicular perforation is more than 2.5 times higher for patients with elevated serum bilirubin levels. It was seen in the patients that with acute appendicitis, total bilirubin was raised more than 1.37 milligram per deciliter. And in cases of appendicular perforation, it was raised for more than 2.47 milligram per deciliter. The sensitivity and specificity of bilirubin in predicting acute appendicitis and perforation diagnosis was 100% and 75.9% respectively in our study. Similarly, the positive predictive value and the negative predictive value of bilirubin in predicting acute appendicitis and appendicular perforation diagnosis was 55.17 and 100% respectively. Coming to conclusion, it is concluded from our study that in patients presenting with right ilia fossa pain with a clinical diagnosis of acute appendicitis, total serum bilirubin level can be estimated and in all cases, and raised serum bilirubin level is having more sensitivity in acute appendicitis and its complications along with high diagnostic accuracy. Serum bilirubin can be used as a criteria to diagnose and manage acute appendicitis. The raise in serum bilirubin was significantly higher in patients with appendicular perforation. It has a definitive predictive potential in these cases. Hence, as isolated hyperbilirubinemia is a significant predictor of appendicular perforation. Serum bilirubin estimation is simple, cheap, easy, available test in every laboratory and can be added to the routine investigation list of clinically suspected case of acute appendicitis for the confirmation of the diagnosis. These are my references.
Thank you, Dr. The paper is now open for discussion.
What is the clinical relevance of the study? What is the take-home message?
Sir, if we have a patient with acute appendicitis and if they're not willing for surgery or anything, then we can correlate with the bilirubin levels. Or if the bilirubin level is high, we can predict that there can be perforation and all. Even the treatment plan, like the need for the drain placement and the need for the paramedian incision can be predicted.
So how long it will take to do a bilirubin test to get a report?
It takes 1 hour, so maximum 1 hour. 30 minutes to 1 hour.
In your hospital?
Yes, in our hospital, yes, sir.
Okay, what is the age cutoff in your case, in your study?
Sir, age cutoff was taken less than 35 years, sir.
Okay. CT scan parameters?
CT scan, we didn't do CT scan, sir. It was based on USG and the clinical examinations.
Okay.
What is the mean bilirubin level in this group?
So, mean bilirubin level was more than 1.2 in case of appendicitis and more than 2.4 in case of appendicular perforations.
If clinically you are suspecting appendicitis.
Chat box. Will you suggest this as a routine test in all appendicitis cases? That is one question.
Sir, if there's no hepatobiliary pathology contraindication, then it can be suggested as a routine test, sir.
There's one more question on the chat box. If clinically you are suspecting appendicitis, but ultrasound is normal.
Yes, sir.
You need to get a CT done. No. What role does LFT play?
The elevated bilirubin levels can tell about the appendicitis, sir. Like sometimes USG, the radiologist might not pick up with retrocecal appendix and all.
How do you differentiate this between liver disease and
From the history and the examinations and RAF tenderness and other factors like rebound tenderness, vomiting and fever.
Thank you so much, sir. So we
Dr. Ravishankar wants to ask a question. Ravishankar, sir.
One more question.
Yes.
Can you come?
Next.
Yes, sir. Sir, you can put it in the chat box, sir. I think you can.
Thank you, Dr. Reddy. Next, we'll go on, continue with the paper presentation from Ambedkar Medical College. I would like to call upon the first speaker from Ambedkar Medical College, Dr. Sanyal Sumbul Rana, presenting a paper on surgical treatment of pilonidal sinus in gluteal cleft, a comparative study of outcome between excision without closure and the limbar flap technique.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Sanyal Rana, presenting a paper on surgical treatment of pilonidal sinus in the gluteal cleft, a comparative study of outcome between excision without closure and Limburg flap technique. Pilonidal sinus is a chronic infection caused by penetration of a foreign body into the subcutaneous tissue in the post-sacral intergluteal region. This foreign body is usually hair, but can be other organic material like wool. In 1833, Herbert Mayo described a hair-containing sinus, but it was not until 1880 that Hodge suggested the term pilonidal to indicate a disease of hair-containing sinus in the sacrococcygeal area. Incidence is reported as 26 per 1,000 population, affecting males 4 times as often as females and predominantly in the young adults. It is associated with considerable morbidity and discomfort, and all the activities of living are affected. Comparative studies in this field are rare, and most of the reports have been limited to single surgical approach with only a few RCTs available. Since most of the surgeries have their own series of complications, we are doing a comparative study of the two commonly done procedures. The clinical presentation may be classified into the following three categories, that is acute pilonidal abscess, chronic pilonidal sinus, which is the commonest clinical presentation, and complex or recurrent pilonidal disease. The aims and objectives of the study was to compare the outcome of excision without closure and Limburg flap technique in the management of chronic pilonidal sinus disease, to analyze the pain, time for wound healing, recurrence rate, cosmetic disfiguration, time taken to get back to work, and other complications or morbidities. Materials and methods: patients admitted with the clinical diagnosis of pilonidal sinus in the gluteal cleft at our hospital. This was a prospective study of a duration of 2 years with a total number of 60 patients, wherein 30 were divided in each category. Routine pre-op and pre-anesthetic evaluation was done, and the choice of anesthesia was final. Follow-up was done by the patient's visit to the OPD and telephonically, and the period of follow-up was from 7 days to 2 years. Inclusion criteria was patients willing to give written informed consent, adult patients 18 years and above, and with chronic discharging sinus or sinuses in the natal cleft with or without the surrounding tissue inflammation and with associated pain and bleeding. Patients excluded from our study were who were not willing to give informed written consent, age less than 18 years, terminally ill patients, uncontrolled diabetes mellitus, patients in immunocompromised state or presenting with acute pyelonidal abscess. So coming to the first technique, that was Limburg flap technique, where the excision and the flap site was mapped and the ratio of the length to the width was 60%. A rhomboid shaped incision was made and continued to the post sacral fascia. The skin was marked by a marker pen after the methylene dye injection and the involved area was excised by a rhomboid excision. So here we can see that A, D, B and C is the primary defect and B, D, E, F is the flap which was used to transpose over the excised area, where F forms the pivot point of flap transposition. Excision without closure, the site was marked 1 centimeter away from the sinus and an elliptical incision was made that extended to the post sacral fascia. The tissue was resected, hemostasis achieved by applying electrocautery and the wound was left to heal by secondary intention. So coming to our results, 10% of our cases in the Limburg flap group were female and 17% of our cases in the excision without closure were females and this was comparable with the literature. Coming to the age group, 36 of our cases were lying in the age group of 25 to 35 years, where the mean age for excision without closure was 27.27 years, and in case of Limburg flap group, it was 29.43 years. Coming to the occupation, the most common occupation in our study was drivers, which was 48.3%. There were also a few IT employees and teachers. So these are the pictures of our patients who presented with pyelonidal sinus. This is the marking for the Limburg flap where the incision was deepened and it was extended up to the post sacral fascia and the flap was created, which was transposed over the excised area and following which hemovacuum drain was placed. And this was the final result. So this is at post-op day 0, post-op day 7, where we can appreciate good healing, at post-op day 14, where there is no wound gaping, and at post-op day more than 3 months. In case of excision without closure, here we can see that at post-op day 7 and post-op day 14, there was some amount of discharge as well as slough. However, at post-op day 21, healthy granulation tissue was present and at post-op day more than 3 months, this is the final result. Coming to the post-operative complications, we encountered seroma, wound dehiscence, and skin necrosis in our Limburg flap group, whereas surgical site infection was seen in 7 of our cases in case of excision without closure. However, this was not statistically significant. Recurrence was seen in 11 of our cases in the excision without closure group, and this was found to be statistically significant. Coming to the hospital stay, the mean hospital stay for Limburg's group was 2.30 years. And for excision without closure, it was 2.30 days and 2.77 days. And this was statistically significant. Time to return to work for Limburg's flap group was 11.4 plus minus 4 days. And for excision without closure, it was 10.5 plus minus 7 days. However, this was not statistically significant, probably because of the low number of patients. When comparing the total time of healing in Limburg's flap group, it was 18 plus minus 5 days. And in excision without closure, it was 31 plus minus 12 days. And this was found to be statistically significant. Coming to the patient satisfaction, we found out that 25 of our cases in the Limburg flap group were satisfied with the result. In case of excision without closure, 15 were satisfied and 15 were somewhat not satisfied. Cosmesis was achieved better with Limburg's group and the overall satisfaction was also higher in that same group. The post-operative pain was measured as per the visual analog score on post-op day 1, day 2, and 1 week, and the comparison was done using the student T-test. So here on post-op day 1, it was statistically significant, and same was seen on post-op day 2. However, it was not significant on post-op 1 week. So coming to the discussion, the mean age category of Limburg's flap group was 29.43 plus minus 5.63 years. And in case of excision without closure, it was 27.27 plus minus 5.01 years. And this was statistically insignificant. In our study, we observed a total hospital stay of 2.77 plus minus 0.43 days for excision without closure and 2.30 plus minus 0.47 days for Limburg's group. And this was comparable with the results of meta-analysis done by Ugur et al. Et al. In his meta-analysis reported a mean of 5.63 days, which was again similar to our results in case of Limburg's group. He also mentioned in his meta-analysis a recurrence rate of 0.6 to 4.8%, denoting a lower recurrence for the flap placement, and this was comparable with our results, which was 6.6%. McCullum et al. In his systematic review stated that surgical site infection in general after any procedure is low. However, rates with open healing were up to 22%, and this was again comparable with our results of 26.6%. So I would like to conclude saying that a shorter hospital stay, early wound healing with shorter time off work and lower ratio of complication favors flap placement. Lower pain perception and improved general health perception adds to the patient comfort and satisfaction. Thus, personal hygiene, periodic epilation of hair and daily wound care are the keystones for preventing recurrence, while proper patient education and cooperation is crucial. This was the performa that was used for the study, and these are my references. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sanyal. Nice presentation, well finished in time. Now the paper is open for discussion, sir.
How did you randomize the patient?
Sir, we did not do randomization of the patients. We had explained the patient about the procedure, both the excision without closure and the Limburg group. And then based on our clinical assessment and then on table, we had divided. So in case when there was a single sinus present, we had already thought for a excision without closure. And in case there were multiple sinuses, we had decided for a Limburg's flap group. So the same was conveyed to the patients. And in case the patient decided to go otherwise, then it was followed.
When was the first follow-up of the patients?
So first follow-up. So follow-up was started on day one, then day seven. Then, sir, 1 month, 3 months, 6 months, and then 2 years.
Yeah, usually the open wounds, they would have much more discharge.
Yes, sir.
Were they followed early or more number of times, frequent?
Yes, sir. Frequent follow-up. Anyways, we are following up till 1 week, sir. And then we are calling based on like 14 days, then 21 days. Then 1 month, then 3 months, then 6 months, then 2 years.
What was the statistics used here?
So
was
we had
it a quantitative or a qualitative?
So we had used the chi-square test, which was to compare the variables and see if there's any relationship. And at the same time, we had used the student t-test.
Yeah, that's right. Chi-square is a qualitative or a quantitative, sir?
So qualitative, sir. Student means, T test is used for the quantitative, for the mean values.
Okay, thank you.
There are a few questions in the chat box. Dr. Nishant wants to say that how did you define time of healing?
So the time of healing was from the day of surgery till it was completely epithelialized. So based on the average day for, because the size of the wound will be differing for each patient. So therefore, based on the dressing and the follow-up and how much hygiene and precaution patient is taking, so the duration will vary. And so we have taken an average of all those of the days that they have taken.
Yeah, there are few more questions in the chat box. Probably it will be answered. Because of lack of time, we will move on to the next paper. Thank you.
Sir,
thank you, sir.
Can I come with one clarification, sir?
Sure, sure, sure.
Yeah, I think for the purpose of the students, all the tests of significance are only for quantitative. For qualitative, you don't have tests of significance. Because, for example, the pain, you convert it into a Wong-Baker scale and then apply statistics. So there are no tests of significance for qualitative. It's only for quantitative. So for the chi-square test and the student t-test are both for quantitative data only.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your valid
input.
Thank you. We'll call upon the next speaker. Next speaker is Dr. Siddhesh Shetty from Ambedkar Medical College. He will be speaking on a paper, Algorithm-Based Approach in the Management of Pressure Source.
Good evening. Today my paper is on algorithm-based approach in management of pressure source, a prospective study. Pressure sore is localized soft tissue injury resulting from unrelieved pressure, usually over a bony prominence. It is seen across all healthcare settings and can affect any age, but most commonly in elderly, resulting in significant morbidity and hospital stay. Patients with pressure sores have comorbidities with underlying risk factors, which makes the hospital stay prolonged. Their associated comorbidities make them poor candidates for anesthesia, resulting in bias in decision-making for the treatment of pressure sores. This results in delay in treatment with inadequate treatment, and most of the times results in improper selection of surgical procedure. In literature, Bhattacharya et al. In his study and Cushing in his evidence-based medicine have proposed algorithm for management of pressure sores. To overcome this bias in decision-making, we have incorporated use of these two algorithms, one which helps in choosing the modality of treatment and the other one which helps in deciding the type of surgery for management of pressure sores in our hospital. We have made use of this algorithm in deciding management of pressure sores. Being a two-year study, we have compared our results with largest studies described in literature. Our aims and objectives are to evaluate outcome of algorithm-based management of pressure sores and to study the results of surgical treatment of pressure sores in terms of hospital stay and cost misses. A source of data are patients with pressure sores in Dr. BRAMC, being a prospective study for duration of 2 years from May 2019 to May 2021, total number of cases being 58, consent from patient and ethical clearance was obtained. This is algorithm for line of management taken from Bhattacharya et al. Initially, we remove the cause, improve the nutrition, control the comorbid disease, and do wound therapy. If slough is absent, we go for dressing. Tissue infection is there, we start with antibiotics. If slough is present with dead tissue, we go for debridement with VAC. Continuing this treatment, if the ulcer is healing, we continue prevention, use water or air bed, improve nutrition, and control comorbid illness. If it's non-healing, being a superficial healthy ulcer, we go for skin grafting. If it's deep ulcer with exposed bone, muscle, or tendon, we go for flap cover. This is an algorithm for choice of surgery, depending on site, taken from Cushing et al. In case of ischium, for a smaller superficial defect, we use a local flap. For large or deep defect, we either use a gluteus musculus flap or a VY hamstring flap. In case of sacrum, for smaller superficial defect, we use either a Lemberg flap or Z-plasty. For large or deep defect, we use a gluteus musculus flap. In case of trochanter, for smaller superficial defect, we use a Lemberg flap. For large or deep defect, we either use a gluteus musculus flap or a tensor fasciae latae VY advancement flap. In case of heel, for smaller superficial defect, we use a local flap. Or large or deep defect, we use a sural artery flap or medial plantar flap. All routine pre-op investigations and pre-anesthetic evaluation was done. Choice of anesthesia was either GA, epidural, or spinal. Analgesics and antibiotics were adjusted to body weight. Follow-up was done telephonically and by patient visits to OPD. Duration of follow-up was from 4 weeks to 2 years. Inclusion criteria included age more than 18 years. Both sexes were included. Malnourished patients, patients with comorbidities, and spinal cord injury patients. Exclusion criteria age less than 18 years. Those who did not give consent, patients with marginal ulcer, COVID-positive patients, and osteomyelitis. In our results, majority were male, which are 41 patients. Our most common age group was 71 to 80, which had 20 patients. Most common site was osteotuberosity, which was 21. Most common risk factor was spinal cord injury, which was 14. Most common grade was grade 4, which was 21. We had done 7 debridements, 4 hydrogel dressings, 9 debridements VAC, 1 skin grafting, 11 Lemberg flaps, 8 Z-plasties, and 18 microtenous flaps. Coming to our complications, we had 1 seroma, 1 hematoma, 2 partial flap necrosis, 1 complete flap necrosis, and 5 recurrences. The mean age of patients in the study was 52.5 years, and the length of the hospital stay was 27 days on an average. These are the clinical features of stages of pressure sore 1, 2, 3, and 4. Here you can see pressure sores of the sacrum and the trochanter, which have led to synergistic gangrenes. Here is an elderly male with chronic medical illness who had a pressure sore of the sacrum, which was managed with hydrogel dressing. There's an elderly female with chronic renal failure who had pressure sores of the sacrum, which was managed with debridement and treatment of the underlying cause. There's an elderly male with terminal illness who had pressure sores of the sacrum, which was managed with VAC with silver impregnated sponge and oxide connected to a suction device with pressure of minus 125 mmHg, which was continuous. The same patient who had pressure sore of the heel, which was managed with again VAC. There's a middle-aged man with pressure sore of the sacrum due to post-operative immobilization. It was initially managed with VAC, resulting in healthy granulation tissue, which was covered with the skin graft. There's an elderly male who had TB of the thoracic spine with empyema thoracic, managed with decompression of the thoracic spine and decortication, which later developed pressure sore on the lower back, which was managed with a Lemberg flap. There's an elderly female with pressure sore of the trochanter with an exposed implant, just closed with Lemberg flap. There's a young traumatic paraplegic patient who had developed pressure of the sacral sore. He was later managed with Z-plasty. This is an elderly male with stroke who had developed pressure sore of the sacrum, which was managed initially with debridement, followed by mobilization of gluteus maximus muscle, which was placed on the sacrum, and primary closure was done with placement of drain. This is a young traumatic paraplegic patient who had pressure sore of the sacrum, which was managed with VY advancement flap. This is a young female with congenital sensory neuropathy who had pressure sores over the bilateral plantar aspect of both the foot. She was managed with cross-leg sural artery flap. This is a young female with congenital paraplegia. She had developed pressure sore in the infragluteal region following use of orthotic device. She was managed with excision and primary closure. This is a young traumatic paraplegic patient who had multiple pressure sores over the trochanter and ischium, imagined with gluteus maximus rotational flap. Mean duration of follow-up in our study was 12.5 months. 8 patients were lost to follow-up. 5 patients had recurrence, which underwent management according to algorithm described in this paper. 2 patients in our study died during the course of hospital stay. Our algorithm-based management outcomes, like complication, flap necrosis, and recurrence, are comparable to outcomes of David L. Larson et al. And Scrivers et al., which are published in international journals, and our hospital stay are comparably less. Management of pressure sores is multifaceted with outcomes related to patients' comorbidities. Algorithm-based decision-making, which is evidence-based for management of pressure sores, is a boon and allows timely intervention, reducing unnecessary operative interventions, and most importantly, unbiased while selecting the treatment for management of pressure sores. Preventive strategies and local wound care, coordinated with knowledgeable team, are essential. Myocutaneous flaps remain workhorse flaps as they provide enough fibrous tissue for large defects and allow revision in case of recurrence. Number of patients in a study was small with short follow-up. Here are my references. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Siddesh. You have finished well in time. And now the paper is open for discussion. There is a question in the chat box from Dr. Lakshman saying that 47 slides for 8 minutes presentation.
Most of it we have shown our clinical photos, so how we have managed the cases. So,
now if I may just butt in, you had slides, data must form the meat of your presentation. You read the first line of your table and you moved on to the next table. We had no time to see the rest of the table. So my request to all the postgraduates, kindly focus on the data. And such a heterogeneous group, my second question, how can anybody conclude with such a heterogeneous group that it's good to do what you have done? There has to be a focus on a particular type of pressure sore, for example, and the study of different methods, and then conclude that this would be good or not good.
So, but we have generally used the most common sites, including pressure sores which are affected, like ischium, sacrum, and the trochanter. And following that, we've tried following an algorithm, so which helps in our timely intervention and early treatment of the patient.
All ulcers were biopsied, and histopath was done before the.
Yes, so we had to rule out Marjolin's ulcer, so most of them we had undergone biopsies and we are doing.
Thank you.
My request is please take the screen to full screen mode, please. When you present, we are recording this also, so it will be useful.
Next presenter, please.
Okay. Thank you, Dr. Siddesh. We'll call upon the next speaker, Dr. Yashaswini from Ambedkar Medical College, to present a paper on laparoscopic management of ventral hernia repair using intraperitoneal synthetic mesh in 10-year retrospective observational study.
Yes, I'm done. Good evening, everyone. I am presenting a paper on laparoscopic management of ventral hernia repair using intraperitoneal synthetic mesh, a 10-year retrospective study. Ventral hernia is an anterior abdominal wall hernia, whether naturally occurring or as a result of previous surgery, comprise most common problems confronting general surgeons with an incidence between 2-13%. Ventral hernia was earlier managed by open technique and without mesh insertion, and the recurrence rates were noted was 31-54%. Laparoscopic ventral hernia repair was first described by Lee Blank in 1993, and this surgical technique has improved over last decade and is being preferred method in many centers throughout the world. Our aims and objectives of a study were to evaluate the long-term outcomes of laparoscopic management of ventral hernia repair using synthetic intraperitoneal mesh and the way we have evolved over a period of 10 years in the management of the same. Parameters assessed were pain, mesh infection, intracutaneous fistula, bowel adhesions, recurrence. Source of our data were the patients admitted with ventral hernia at Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Medical College and Hospital, Bangalore. Study design being retrospective observational study of a duration 10 years with 821 subjects. Our approach was laparoscopic IPOM and IPOM Plus, and we had given a choice of a mesh to the patient to be incorporated during the surgery, and the choices were polypropylene mesh, dual mesh, composite mesh, and titanium mesh. We fixed the mesh with tackers and transfacial sutures. Defect was closed with shoelace technique. Our intracorporeal suturing was done. Follow-up was done in OPD and telephonically. Follow-up period being 6 months to 10 years with a mean follow-up of 5.72 years. Age group above 18 years, symptomatic patients with primary incisional and recurrent ventral hernias, defect size between 2 cm to 6 cm were included in our study. All patients less than 18 years, strangulated ventral hernia, patient unfit for laparoscopic surgeries under GA, BMI over 30 were excluded out of our study. This was a routine pre-op workup which was done for all the patients in our study. We have employed majority of our patients, we have employed two-port technique, and third port was used only when intracorporeal suturing or bowel adhesiolysis was required. These were the operative steps, and mesh anchoring was done with or without the defect closure, and pressure dressing was placed. This was a routine post-op advice given to all the patients. This is an intra-op image of our IPOM technique wherein mesh is placed without defect closure. Intra-op image of our IPOM Plus technique wherein defect is closed and then mesh is placed with the help of tackers. Image of a composite mesh. This is a surface marking of a dual mesh which is being placed intraperitoneally. Results: majority of our patients were belong to primary hernia category, accounting to 801 in number. Incisional hernia were 12 in number, following post-open appendicectomy, open cholecystectomy, nephrectomy, and LSCS. Recurrent hernia, we had patients, and all of them had undergone IPOM previously. Majority of our patients were female and fell in an age group between 41 to 50 years with a mean age of 45.62 years. Majority of our patients had a defect size of 2 to 3 centimeters with average defect size of 2.41 centimeters. In 80% of our patients, we have done IPOM Plus technique. Polypropylene mesh was used in 57% of our patients, followed by dual, titanium, and then composite. In primary hernias, we have used all types of synthetic meshes. In majority of our patients, we have fixed the mesh using transfacial fixation with Vicryl, and tackers was used only in 8 patients. Coming to the complications, we have encountered bleeding in 3 patients following injury to inferior epigastric artery, seroma in 8 patients, wound infection in 4, stitch abscess 2, recurrence 8, mesh infection 6, chronic pain and foreign body sensation 4, transfacial suture site hernia 3, and chronic discharging sinus 3. These were the mesh-related complications wherein we have observed 8 cases of recurrence. In patients with 5 patients, we had used polypropylene mesh, and 3 patients wherein we had used dual mesh. Mesh infection was seen in 6 patients of a dual mesh, and foreign body sensation was felt by 4 patients in whom we had used polypropylene mesh previously. This is an image of an infected mesh, and this is after explantation with tackers in situ. Image of a recurrent hernia wherein after adhesiolysis, here you can see the mesh is herniating into the defect site. Coming to the discussion, the closure of primary facial defect, that is IPOM Plus, has improved outcomes, citing lower recurrence rates, lower rate of seroma formation, and improved patient satisfaction. Our approach was IPOM technique in 16% of our cases in early part of our study, during which we have recorded around 8 cases of seroma formation, and also that the patient was not satisfied with regards to the defect being found on imaging for some other abdominal pathology during follow-up period. Hence, we evolved by employing IPOM Plus technique, which was incorporated in 81% of cases, following which we did not record any seroma formation, and also that the patient had better satisfaction. Mesh infection and erosion is a challenging complication and is higher in uncoated polypropylene mesh. However, EPTFE and polyester can erode as well, resulting in uncontrolled fistula and necrotizing fasciitis of abdominal wall. A total of 6 cases of mesh infection was noted in dual meshes only, with the recurrence rate of the mesh infections rate of 0.7% in our study, which is comparable to literature, which is less than 1%. Though polypropylene mesh was used in highest numbers in our study, none of them had any complications with regards to intracutaneous fistula or bowel adhesion, which is comparable to other studies. The type of mesh and mesh used and the mesh location plays an important factor with regards to recurrence, of which sublay and intraperitoneal repairs have the least recurrence rates. It is noted that a 5 cm mesh overlap overall from the defect generally is accepted as an ideal and also to prevent recurrences. Carbogio et al. Claimed low recurrence rates of 1.4 and 4.4% for tacks and transfacial sutures respectively. In our study, a total of 8 cases of recurrence were noted with a defect size of 3 to 5 cm where all of them had undergone IPOM repair using polypropylene and dual mesh. In these cases, mesh fixation was done by transfacial proline suture. In initial days of management, we used 3 cm overlap, which was probably led to the recurrences in our study. Apart from mesh overlap discrepancy, we suspect that non-incorporation of tackers for mesh fixation has also added to the recurrence rates. Hence, we incorporated a standard protocol of mesh overlap of 5 cm beyond the defect edge, depending on the defect size, and recorded a decreased recurrence rates. And with regards to recurrence related to fixation device, as per the literature, the recurrence rate is approximately 4% compared to 0.98% in our study with the use of sutures. These are the different studies done in the literature whose results are comparable to ours with the recurrence rates of 0.98% with no bowel fistulization and no intracutaneous fistula. When it comes to the severity of post-op pain or fixation site hernia, it is related to mesh fixation technique. In our study, we have fixed the mesh by using proline number 1 suture material through a transfacial technique placed in 6 to 8 sites of mesh in majority of our cases, which was done in initial days and found out that patients had chronic pain and foreign body sensation, stitch abscess, chronic discharging sinus, and a few rare cases of suture site hernia due to over-tightening of suture knots, causing tissue necrosis and defect. Hence, we evolved over to use absorbable suture material, that is Vicryl number 1, for mesh fixation by a transfacial technique and also by practicing how to excessively tighten the suture knots, which gave satisfactory results by lowering the incidence of post-stemming complications. Over a period of 10 years, we have learned that IPOM plus technique has improved outcomes. The safety and efficacy profile of intraperitoneal polypropylene mesh using IPOM or IPOM plus technique is comparable to that of other synthetic meshes. A mesh overlap of minimum 5 cm beyond the defect is a must to minimize the hernia recurrence. Absorbable suture material can be used or considered as an alternative to tackers to secure the mesh through a transfacial technique and to make sure not to over-tighten the knot over the tissue. Conclusion, with the advent of newer laparoscopic technique for ventral hernia, laparoscopic IPOM and IPOM plus holds good in small and medium-sized hernias with least complications. IPOM and IPOM plus technique is easily reproducible and has a short learning curve. Shortcomings of our study being low recurrence rates were probably due to exclusion of patients over 30 BMI and 10% of our patients were lost to follow. These are my references. Thank you.
What was the follow-up protocol in your case?
Now the paper is open for discussion.
What is the follow-up protocol in your case?
So we have followed the patients telephonically and whenever patients visit to OPD post-op, sir, and for a follow-up period only we had started like from 6 months to 10 years.
You had recurrence cases, no?
Yes,
what
sir.
Is the duration from the surgery in these cases?
So within like 2 to 3 months, they had recurred, sir.
Within 2 to 3 months. Okay. Yours is a retrospective study.
Yes,
then
sir.
How was the choice of the measures given to the patient?
At the time of presentation only, patients were given choice, sir. And when we have studied the files retrospectively, and then we have categorized into the different subjects, sir.
Okay. How were the your larger defects managed?
Sorry, sir.
How were the larger defects managed in your case?
Lateral defects. Lateral in our study was a spigel and hernia.
6 centimeters.
Six centimeters hernia was managed by IPOM plus technique only, sir. Laparoscopic, and that we encountered only one in our study.
Thank you.
Thank you.
There are a few questions in the chat box. If time permits and floor permits, I can read out those questions. how was the patient that has been answered, and how did you fix the mesh without tackers?
So we have used transfacial fixation. In early part of our study period, we have used proline. And after that, when we noted chronic pain and other complications which I mentioned, we changed over to vicryl suture material, sir.
Madam, you said you used only 6 to 8 transfacial. Is it sufficient to prevent recurrence? They say the tackers or sutures should be used to be at least one or two centimeters in between. So only 6 sutures means you are leaving a gap of so much.
So ideally,
how can it prevent recurrence?
Sir, we are using a bigger size of mesh, sir.
I know you are using a bigger size of mesh, but you are using only 6 transfacial sutures. What is the gap between the two sutures?
Yes, sir. Guidelines say that, sir, in, within a parameter, I mean, within a centimeter, 4 centimeter parameter around the mesh, we have to secure the transfacial sutures, sir. But in our study, we have done, we have fixed the meshes in 6 to 8 sutures, sir.
No. The gap between the two sutures should be less than 2 centimeters. That's how you it prevent recurrence.
Yes, sir.
There is a question from Lakshman, sir.
How what is the cost of this port site hernia? You are using only that needle. How can hernia develop in that port site? Sorry.
Sir, patient, like here we have not categorized the patients according to comorbidities. Probably the like patient may be diabetic or any immunocompromised patient have more chances of developing.
You are assuming the thing, sir.
And it also like tight suture material wherein we have fixed the transfacial techniques, wherein we have used more tighter ligature that also might have caused suture site hernia, causing necrosis at the facial defects.
One more question from the Lakshman sir, saying that how did you get data from patients operated more than 5 years previously?
So we have sir, we have records in our MRD.
No, correct me if I'm wrong, but I didn't see any data about how many patients were seen for what length of time. After what length of time, you know, somebody was X number of patients were followed up for 6 months, Y for 1 year, Z for 1.5 or 5, whatever. That kind of data has to be provided in any study. Did you have that? Did I miss it or was it not given?
No, sir, that I have not mentioned
in
our
study.
Yeah,
that is crucial for a study like this, please. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Thanks. Sir, as there are some more questions in the chat box, and most of the questions are taken up, and that with the time is already we are delay late, and we conclude the session with the permission of the president and the secretary and the floor. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
So I have a few announcements to make. Just I'm reminding. So we are conducting a virtual CME on 19th, coming Saturday, between 7 to 8:30 p.m. on perioperative blood transfusion management. It's my kind request for all the members. So make it a successful program as today. So today we have crossed more than 100 participants. So we'll try to, create the YouTube link for the Saturday program. So the next June 26th is the Surgeons Day. So it is planned for a virtual platform. For that also, it's my kind request for the Fraternity of Surgical Society Bangalore to participate in a large number and make the program successful. And the next MCM, 14 July, hosted by Sagar Hospital. So with that, we came to the end of the program.
Thank the hosting institutions.
Before announcing the results, I thank hosting institution represented by Dr. Ramesh B.S. sir, HOD of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Medical College, and Dr. Ramesh Reddy sir from Vaidehi Medical College for this, you know, wonderful scientific program. So very good coordination between the two medical colleges, and wonderful posters and papers. And it was a successful program, as the audience more than 100. So I thank both the HODs and all the staff of the both the medical colleges. And I congratulate all the postgraduates from both the medical colleges for their very good involvement and participation. So I thank one and all for your valuable time and participation for this program. So we come to the results. The best poster is decided by judges as a rare case of giant egist of wild variant by Dr. Viksha Shetty from Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Medical College. The best papers, surgical treatment of pyelonidal sinus in gluteal cleft, a comparative study of outcome between excision without closure and limbar flap by Dr. Sanyal Sambal Rana from Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Medical College. The next best paper is the laparoscopic management of ventral hernia repair using intraperitoneal synthetic mesh, a 10-year retrospective observation study by Dr. Ashaswini Karati from Dr. B.R. Ambedkar Medical College. I congratulate on behalf of Surgical Society of Bangalore both the presenters. So I thank one and all. Before concluding the program, we stand for a national anthem. I request Nishant to play the national anthem.
जन गण मन अधिनायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विधाता पंजाब सिंध गुजरात मराठा द्राविड उत्कल बंगा विंध्य हिमाचल यमुना गंगा उच्चल जलधि तरंगा तव शुभ नामे जागे तव शुभ आशीष मागे गाहे तव जय गाथा जन गण मंगल दायक जय हे भारत भा